It's a principle.
Yes.
One day you will, so why not?
One day.
We will start, first time. This is the first lecture series, first lecture of the lecture series, Friday lecture series for the year 2004 and 2005. And we are very fortunate to have two very distinguished professors who are coming to talk to us about the new book that they are going to be publishing. Is it published already?
No.
No. That in the process of being published, and it's called Striped Zebra. The first presenter, Dr. Uday, is a retired professor of English and linguistics who obtained his PhD at the age of 65 and has taught at the university level for 40 years. Dr. Naval's dissertation topic on intrasentential code switching is presented a unique theory of C concepts. And this theory explains why speakers resist the use of certain foreign words when speaking in their native tongue. And Dr. Soofia Hussain is a full professor of sociology at Nassau Community College, Garden City. She has a doctorate from Columbia University and specializes in the areas of family, gender roles, and bureaucracy, besides, of course, migration. Dr. Hussain is the author of many published articles and has presented extensively at professional conventions. Please welcome Dr. Naval and Dr. Hussain.
Thank you.
You want to sit there and talk among
Yes, I mean, okay.
But maybe we should put this.
Where's that?
Yes, over here.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, and I'll do the same thing with Dr. Okay. Hussain.
Thank you.
Well, good evening, gentlemen. First of all, I want to recognize the tremendous work that Dr. Tam has put in over the past 2, 3, 4 years. This series is the only program of its kind that I personally am aware of, where every week, you know, every week, people are invited to speak on a diversity of topics and to arrange like 35, 40 lectures like that without any break. I mean, this requires tremendous work and dedication. And Tom, I really appreciate the fact very much. Next, can you introduce yourself to me, please? No, you are a young man. Your voice should be vibrant and strong. It should be heard.
My name is Jonas Siriger. I am a City College student.
Yeah.
Senior year.
Majoring in?
International studies.
Okay. Very good.
My name is Nick Feng. I'm from Baruch College.
Baruch College?
Uh-huh.
Okay.
I'm majoring in finance.
I'm an alumni of City University, currently retired.
Okay. All right. Thank you. This is how the book will look like. Not this is how it will look like. This is the manuscript of the book. When it is published, it will look quite different. We have about 200 pages, and the title, yes, the title of the book is Striped Zebra, The title is Scribe Zebra, : The Immigrant Psyche. Psyche, as you know, means the mind. And what we have claimed here in this work is that the mind of an immigrant is like that, is the metaphor. Is that, you know, what is metaphor when you compare something with something else? So the metaphor of Scribe Zebra suggests that the mind of the immigrant is like the stripes of the zebra. The zebra stripes are black and white, and they do not meet anywhere on the body of that animal. So what we are saying is that when the immigrant is in his or her native land, he or she has kind of a unified mind. But when the same person migrates to a foreign culture, a foreign land, then what happens in the mind and the thinking of the immigrant is that it bifurcates the mind, the thinking processes, bifurcate into two kind of streaks. Streaks means lines. They run parallel to each other and they do not meet. So one of those streaks can be called as the nativity, the native line of thought in the immigrant's mind. The second can be called as the acculturation streak. Acculturation means what is it that the immigrant accepts and imbibes, assimilates from the new society, which technically is called the host society, H-O-S-T. Now this word host might be somewhat misleading, because many societies, they accept their immigrants kind of in a willy-nilly fashion. It is not that they have invited. What is a host? If you are a guest and you go to some friend's house and you go there as a guest, then the other friend is a host or hostess. And that is the counterpart of the guest and the other relationship. Now, there are very few societies that want, they actively go out to invite immigrants. The best thing that they do is to open their gates for their own selfish reason. But when the immigrants come, they generally do not get a very proper treatment. And there are examples of very, very deadly examples of discrimination. We have all, most of us, experienced in our jobs, in our social situations, in our relations with people, in what's called the glass ceiling, and in other matters. So it is called, the society is called the host society, but still, I mean, it is, we will use that term, although, as I said, that society does not act too much like a very gracious host to immigrants. All right, now this book, I said that there are two kinds of streaks, two kinds of lines. We have called them the seeds and the feeds, S-E-E-D, seed. Seed is what they bring from their native culture, and feed is what they assimilate from their from the local society. Local means the host society. Now I might mention in passing that at this time in the world, with a population of six billion people, about 3% are migrants. 3% of the world population are migrants. That means they are not living in the countries, societies where they were born in. So there is a sizable, I mean, it is not a very numerically a big number, but their impact on the human race is very substantial. In our this work, Our first chapter is called Man, the Eternal Migrant. And we say that in the history of the human race, if you go back to tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of years ago, you will find that man has been moving. The origin of man took place in somewhere in Africa. And then the man, human beings, that means men and women, they spread onto the seven continents of the planet. That is because of migration. And whether the migrations are voluntary or whether even invasions, you see one country invades another and settles there, like Muslims came from Central Asia and settled in India, and similarly things must have happened of that nature in the Far East and everywhere, all over Europe, everywhere. So people have been on the move all the time. So this is what is happening, that migration is not something rare or something coincidental or something of a secondary importance, but migration has been a kind of a leaven that has leavened the whole human race. And wherever the migrant goes, the migrant takes his or her ways of living, ways of thinking, cultural values and others, and when migrants settle there, then those the interchanges take place. So the world is kind of made, whatever it is today, how we look at it, whatever we see in the world today is the result of migrations in the past. And today these migrations are having even greater impact. Why? Because of two reasons. One is the ease of transportation. You see, there was times when about 100 years ago or even less, when people went from one country to another by ship, and it took a month or more than that. And they kind of burnt their boats behind, and they knew that they have spent a month or two in reaching a foreign land, and therefore they cannot easily go back. But today, in the past 50 years, with the increase in what you call air travel, now there are people who go back to their countries or wherever they want to go once or twice or three times a year. There are people who are doing businesses. There is some example which we have quoted in the book, an Indian gentleman. He was asked, "Where do you live?" His answer, look at this, his answer. He says, "I have business in Belgium. My wife is a professor in Canada, and my parents live in Calcutta. My son goes to the MIT, and my daughter is over there, and so that, where is his home?" I mean, he is moving from one place to another all the time. And this is what is called transnationalism kind of developing. And the governments want to encourage this kind of thing. And there are governments who are providing what is called the device of the facility of dual citizenship. India, my country, has passed recently a law that you can retain your Indian citizenship while you are at the same time an American citizen. In Dominican Republic, and there are many, many countries, and this trend is increasing. So this is what is happening. Now, to take some figures, out of in 1960, there were 75 million people living abroad. And in 2000, for which the latest figures I have, the number of people living abroad is 150 million. About 40, 50 years ago, 4 or 5 million people moved. In the year 2000, 22 million people moved, migrated. And that includes both legal and illegal. Now there are costs and benefits to migration. Migration benefits, I mean there's a price to be paid, but migration helps both the sending countries and the receiving countries. And we will not, we probably do not have the time to go through all that, but I'll just mention one thing, and that is that in the countries of the West, there is a population implosion taking place. Implosion means what? That the population is decreasing. The number of babies born is not enough to maintain the existing level of population. Whereas in the third world countries, third world in a very generic sense, that means Asia and Africa and some parts of South America and so on. So there is surplus population. Now, when the population implosion, the population deficit countries, now they are getting older and they are living longer. The result is that they need manpower. In the place where I live, I go for a walk. They have big houses there with huge lawns. But what I see is that all the workers are from Mexico. They are all doing the dirty work. And they are called, you see, they are doing what's called the 4D jobs. 4D is what? Dirty, dangerous, degrading, and demanding. Hard. The local people are not willing to cut your lawn and to do all those things. So it helps the host societies to have people coming in. So it is in our last thing. We have given, Dr. Soofia, Hussain and I, we have given the vision of one world. We believe that the migrant, man has always been a migrant. But today in the 21st century, man is a migrant, is helping to bring the world together in a way that has perhaps not been done to that extent any time in the history of the human race. So migrants and the reason and the how their migrants are able to do that, migrant brings his own values, his culture, ways of thought and so on. And then the host society borrows something from the migrant, and the migrant borrows something from the host society. With the result that there is this intermixture is going on. I'm not talking of intermarriages and all that, but the cultural interaction and intermixture, and that is reducing prejudices. Imagine that you have never heard of an Indian, or never saw an Indian. You had heard that there is a country like India where there are elephants and snake charmers, this, that and the other. But then you see two Indians, and then you talk to us, and you feel that we have, I mean, if you pinch us, if you prick with a needle, our blood will flow just as your own blood will flow, right? So, then if you haven't seen one or two Indians, you will say they cannot be all that bad because they are like human beings like ourselves. So the point is that we might have heard stories about, you know, negative stereotypes, but when we come across those people and they work for us and they help us, then our prejudice breaks down. And that means that there is greater understanding between different sections of people. All right, now let me come to the point of my, you see, it will take a long time if I covered every single point, even if I have to mention, just to mention and nothing else. All right, what we need to do is look at some seed values. Seed values, as we said, are those values which people bring from their own culture. Now, if a European, if a Britisher comes to America, the difference between the seed and the feed is very little. Why? Because Western society in England, the language is more or less the same, right? Except for dialectal differences. And the ways of thinking and behavior are also more, there are differences. but those differences are not that great. But supposing a Mongol, a resident of Mongolia, comes over to America, you can imagine that the difference will be very huge. So the difference between the seed and feed are not constant. They vary according to the ethnic distance between the host society and the immigrant's own native society. Now, in order to prove a point, you have to take the biggest contrast. So, let us take the example of Asians. All of us present here are Asians. Let's take that example. Now, in Asian cultures, the important seed values within the family are basically two, in my opinion. Three or four, actually. One is of male authority. In Asian societies, it is thought that the man of the house, he is the leader of the family, he is the provider, and he has more wisdom, he has all kinds of he has power, which comes from his having being the provider and the earning member of the society. I'm not talking of the modern, what you call, because societies, even the Asian societies, are changing very fast because of the global effect of the TV, the media, and the cell phone now, and international travel and so on. So those societies are changing. But if you take a traditional society of like 40, 50 years ago even, you will find that within the family, there are certain values which are not found in the Western society and which are found in the Eastern society and other, even South American society and African society. Of course, there are internal differences, but still. So one value is the male authority. So when the family moves, the tendency or the desire of the man of the house to perpetuate his authority, because that is the only thing he knows about. He has seen his father and his other male members in his culture behaving in a certain way, and he thinks that perhaps is the best way, and that perhaps is the only way. Then there is the question of the parental authority. The parents, here when we talk of parents, we include the mother as well. The father and the mother, they believe that they have to guide the lives of their younger children in the best possible way. And they think that the children should be obedient to them, because they think that children, the young children, do not exactly know what is right and wrong for them. They might be aiming at what is called, in this American culture, instantaneous gratification. So they may not want to put in the effort that is needed in order to build character, in order to build a career, and in order to develop into a good human being. And therefore, the children should be obedient to the parent. The third thing is that there is a great, plenty of emphasis, on the value of the extended family. Here in the West, the family is what's called the nuclear family. That means husband, wife, and the children. And I give you a very unpleasant example of myself. In India, there is a custom once a year where a sister sends a band to the brother. And the brother puts the band on, and that band is a little decorative piece made of colored threads and so on, and it signifies the brother's obligation to protect his sister. Okay, so when I was here in 1970, the very first year, so I received bands from my sisters at that time, and I put them on, and I said I should keep them for one day. All right. So there were two or three bands from my two or three sisters, and I had them on, and I went to my evening job. an American supervisor. He asked me, "What is this?" I said, "This is a token of my sister's affection for me, and she being a woman, she expects that I should be protecting her. It's her effect." And that man, in a very cynical manner, he said, "The next thing you will find is that they will put a noose around your neck."
Oh, no.
I mean, they could not even conceive that the brother-sister relationship can be sacred, can be very beautiful, can be mutual. And he said, "Then they will put a noose around your neck. That means they will kind of strangulate you." I mean, that was very fear. I mean, this shows the difference in thoughts. So in extended families, the value of relatives outside your nuclear family, your parents, aged parents, your grandparents, your uncles, even your cousins, it is given a high value. Another thing, respect for the elders. I was taking some physical therapy from a gentleman from Philippines. He said, I said, "What do you miss in America? You have been here for 4 or 5 years. He said, "I miss the respect that we give to our elders." He says, "If I met somebody who was my elder relative, I would do like this. I will take his hand and I'll put it on my, and I will kiss it like that." Mark of respect. In Indian culture, they touch your feet. Your children, your daughters-in-law, sons-in-law, grandchildren, they will touch your feet. Now, these are ritualistic gestures, but behind that, there is a feeling that if they, because they're elders, they become old and they become sick, then it is your duty to take care of them, not send them to nursing homes. And there they are waiting for even a phone call, and the phone call never comes. So that kind of thing. So these are the values. Dr. Hussain will give you a couple of stories about this thing, and I will now mention a few more things, and then I'll request her to add what we have missed here. The question is, what are the feed values? When people come from the third world country, then what is it that they want to imbibe, assimilate from like American culture? The most fundamental of these values is what is called the American dream, quote unquote. What is American dream? You should have a house in the suburbs, you should have 2 or 3 cars, your children should go to soccer games and swimming and this, that and the other, and the mom should be driving them around, you know, all that kind of thing, which is strictly materialistic. The American dream does not have too many of what's called the ethical and the moral values. And this American dream doesn't mean America as such. It means, this is now a generic term, even if somebody from East goes and settles in Canada or even France and Germany, still you see the American dream means material wealth and prosperity and a comfortable life. Now, in order to realize the American dream, what people need to do is they realize that they come without much money, capital, so they realize that they have to get education. And education is the surest and the quickest means to realize the American dream. So, you have youngsters here who are going to college and so on. Of course, when I did my doctorate at the age of 65, I certainly believed in the value of education. And then there are individual rights. Now, a very interesting thing happens within the family. Imagine that husband, wife and a child, they migrate from the Eastern world to America or any European country. Now, the husband will like to maintain his male dominance. But when the wife watches the TV, and moves around, you see, and talks to her friends and co-workers, and then she says, no, women have rights here, which they did not have over there. So there is a split. What is a seed value for the man becomes a feed value for the wife. The man wants to continue his male dominance, whereas the wife wants to become freer and more independent. So we have a couple of interesting examples of how these things happen. Again, the kids' rights. As I said, in the Eastern culture, kids are supposed to obey the parents and respect them, help them, and be guided by them. There's the story of a Bangladeshi man who was here 5, 6, 7 years only, and he had his boy, son, who was now about 11 or 12 years old, and he was watching the TV. And the father shouted from the other room, Ahmed, come over. He said, coming, Dad. Another half an hour passed. Then father again, I'm asking you to come over, please help me. He says, coming. Another 1 hour passed. The kid could not, get up and stop watching the TV. The father came and he slept like that. I've told you so many times. Okay. What did the boy do? He stood up, turned around, looked his dad squarely in the eye and said, if you hit me again, I will call 911. Now, the father was steeped in his native culture. He didn't say anything. He sat down on the sofa and for 10 minutes kept shaking his head like that. He was so much stunned. He didn't say anything. Okay, 5, 6, 7 months later, summer vacation came. And they said, all right, let's all go to Bangladesh. The capital is Dhaka. Okay, they were all very happy. All right, the father, mother, the son, all went there. On reaching Dhaka, they slept for 2 or 3 days because of the jet lag. And then on the 4th or 5th day, the man called his wife and son, come here, sit down. And from his bag, he took out the passports, all the 3 passports. Then he said to his wife, bring some matchsticks. She said, what do you want matchsticks for? He said, come on, I'm telling you, bring some matchsticks. She brought matches. Like that, and burnt number 1, number 2, number 3, all the passports. And then the man struck his son again and said, now you call 911. We are done with America. We are not going there. Okay, now my final point is that the immigrant starts being a striped zebra, but after living for 20, 30, 40 years abroad, because mind is pliable, mind is not like a piece of stone, nothing happens to it. Mind becomes gradually influenced, little by little by little. In some cases it happens more quickly, in other cases less quickly. But most of the striped zebras remain striped zebras no more. They become what is called spotted leopards. So spotted leopards is metaphor again. What does that show? You have a native skin, native color of the skin, and you have a patch of acculturation here, a patch here, a patch here, like that. So you are not as rigid as you were when you came first to the host society, then you, sometimes you see, you don't want your children, for example, to marry out of the race. Okay? The child goes ahead and says, marriage, you know, without your consent or without your approval. Now that is your child after all. You are angry for 1 or 2 years, you don't speak with them, you don't call them. Then you see the mother becomes impatient, she says, we've got to know what they are doing, how they are. So after 5, 10 years people say, well, what can we do? It is their life, I mean it is their choice, we cannot impose our values too much on them. When that kind of thing happens, then people, the migrant becomes spotted leopard. Finally, our claim is that our hypothesis of striped zebra is universal and global. It is not Chinese people coming to America, Indians going to Canada, or Indian Bangladesh is going to England. No. Wherever, all over the globe, whoever, whichever country the immigrant comes from, and whichever country the immigrant goes and settles in, the striped zebra hypothesis will apply to them. Thank you. I need 1 week for my presentation, not half an hour.
That's all right.
If you like, you can ask questions or we can have a discussion, but I suggest that let Dr. Soofia, yeah, she will tell us that our hypothesis was tested, field tested. We gave a questionnaire of 60 items and we gave it to 700 plus students and we got their responses, which we analyzed in the computer. We have about 1,000 tables of the analysis, and she will mention those things.
Yeah, hello. I would like to give you some statistics and interpretation of the data. So as Dr. Naval mentioned, we did a big survey of 60 questions in a questionnaire, and we polled over 700 students. They were ESL students, taking English as a second language, and they were immigrant. So in terms of feed and seed value, our hypothesis is proved by our data that immigrants keep their seed values and take some values from the host society, but seed values are extremely important for them for quite some time. So I'll give you some data. Because of the time, I would be discussing 4 or 5 major points of seed and feed values. Number one is spousal relations. So we have a question, and the question was that husband is not always an authority. Wife can assert her will too. And our data show that 51% of the people said that this is an American value, and 35% of the respondents said it is value of host society as well as native society. And 14% said it is native value. Okay. Now the thing is, 75% of the respondents want to keep this value, which means that men and women immigrant to the United States say that wife should assert herself too. Husband is not an authority all the time. That's what they said. But as you know, and we have seen, that this is, they proclaim, they say, they believe. But is it implemented? No, it is not implemented. So what immigrant men and what immigrant women do, they do mostly their traditional work. Women are responsible for all household work and cooking, as well as taking care of the children. And they also work for paid employment. Okay, men, they are the breadwinner, and they may help whenever they feel like, but they do not take full-fledged responsibility of, you know, some good percentage of work. Whenever they feel like, whenever they are in a mood, they can do that. They can participate in the taking care of home and children. I want to give you my own personal example in this connection. And that is, I'm from India, as you know. I got married after doing my PhD, and my husband was an international lawyer and very highly educated person, and we were in love. We lived together. Then I got this job after my PhD. The job was in Nassau, and I didn't drive at that time, so I used to get up very early in the morning, before dawn, would take subway to Penn Station, would take Long Island train, would come to Westbury Station, would take a bus if I'm lucky, or take a cabbie, and cabbie would give me a ride, you know, to all over Long Island, and then I come to my class, and I'm the junior most, so they gave me very early classes. So my class would start at 8:30 in the morning. Okay. So that was my schedule. Now, my husband was very proud of me that I am very well educated and a professor, and he wants to show off to his friends and relatives and his people that his wife is so accomplished. She's a professor, a PhD, but she knows sumptuous cuisine. And my province in India is famous for its cuisine. So he would order me that he's going to invite such and such people and please prepare the food. So what I'll do, for Indian cooking, as you know, I have to go to Indian shop to buy all the, you know, ingredients. Then I'll cook for 3-4 nights because I'm working. Then he'll say, okay, the food is ready. What you do when you come back from your job, do not enter into the apartment in your Western clothes. Western clothes are not appreciated, and you don't look very good in Western clothes. So what you do when you come home, you be dressed like an Indian woman. So I didn't know what to do. I take my clothes and go to a neighbor and put my clothes there. When I come back, I take shower, change into Indian dress, then come to my apartment. And then, of course, play the traditional, you know, housewife role. Gracious hostess. And I was supposed to keep quiet, never say anything. No matter I'm educated, I have an opinion, but I was supposed to just do my job and shut up most of the time. I remember one time Supreme Court Justice of Bangladesh was invited. So I cooked for 3 days, 3 nights. Okay? So now the guests came, and I was there in my traditional dress. And they were talking about suicide. And was speaking about nonsense about suicide. Suicide is a sociological phenomenon, as you know, and I know all those theories by heart. I grew up with them. So I opened my mouth and I said, okay, I would like to mention Emile Durkheim, who is a French philosopher, and his ideas of suicide. The greater the integration of the individual with society, the lesser the likelihood of committing suicide. So that's it. People who commit suicide are not very well integrated. That is one part of his theory. So my husband didn't like that, you know, I am questioning the Supreme Court Justice and I am voicing my opinion. And he was very angry with me for several days. So it means that, you know, you go to graduate school, do your PhD, find a job as professor, and dress traditionally when it is required, do sumptuous cooking and play the role of traditional hospitality, you know, person. So And that's what I experienced. And especially, I mean, he could work with me, do the cooking, all right, but when his people are there, or his friends are there, he would like to play the role of the traditional man, and would like me to play the role of the traditional, you know, wife. Okay, the second aspect I would like to discuss is parent-child relations. Now, in Asian countries, you know, there are certain things which are very important between parents and children. One is, which is called in Chinese culture, you know, filial piety. And you love your children, of course, but you have to be very strict with them. And that is good for your children. And that is higher form of, you know, caring, if you are very strict and you discipline them. What children are supposed to do? Children are supposed to follow rules and must be obedient. And so that is an ideal we all practice. So there was a question in our survey. Children should obey their parents and should not be quick to challenge parents. Okay, in our data, it shows that 57% of male and female say this is a native value. Okay, and 31% said it is the value of both American and native culture. 85% of males and females want to keep this value, that children should be obedient and should follow rules and must not ever challenge parents. So the seed values are still, you know, very much in the mind of parents with regard to their children. Then we had question about extended family, and we see that, you know, Asian people value extended family very much. So we had question about how much help you want to, how much money you want to send, how much help you want to provide to your, you know, native people, and the data is very fascinating. 78% people, both male and female, they said that they would like to help relative very much in the home country. Okay. And 68% said they would like to sponsor them to the United States very much, whenever they can. And the same percentage, 68%, said they would like to keep them in their own home from 6 months to 1 year. And 78% said that they would like to provide financial support to immigrant relatives in America. So that's very interesting, that we are in the United States, but we are very much attached to our native land and, you know, extended family, and have very extremely fond memories, and would like to do whatever we could, and going through hardships ourselves, but try to do something for them. Now, another question was about elderly people in the family or in the neighborhood. So 51% of the people responded said that it is a native value, the respect for the elderly people. And 35% said that it is the value of both countries, native country and host country. Now, 94% of the total respondents said they would like to keep this value very much, respect for the elderly. Now, I just want to say, as you know already, that, you know, in Asian culture, in developing countries' culture, elderly are extremely, extremely important. Extremely important, because they raise us in many, many times. They are like substitute mother and father for us. And grandparents and grandchildren are very close. Grandparents typically do not discipline us, right? They let us do whatever we want to do. And we seek them for support and affection and love, which they provide in abundance, and have a special relationship. I remember in my family, a grandmother telling me that she confides in her granddaughter. Whenever there is some secret, she shares it with her. She give her things to hide from other people, some jewelry or something. So a special relationship between grandmother and granddaughter and grandfather and grandson is very common. Now, I remember in my childhood, I have my maternal grandmother, who was kind of leftover woman. Her husband married again and she was this elderly woman and living in big mansion. And she has about 40, 45 grandchildren. And we were around her all the time. And she was a source of knowledge and history, family history, and fun. And she used to tell us Arabian Nights stories. You know, in Arabian Nights there are 1001 stories, like Magic Carpet, Aladdin, all those stories she used to tell us. So what I'm trying to say is that, you know, in traditional societies, developing countries, we have oral culture, which means that in face-to-face interaction, you communicate directly with your elderly people and have great feeling of belongingness, support and love. And you seek them out all the time. And it's so much fun. So our hypotheses are supported by our data. And immigrants, when we come to this country, we think that we'll find many, many things which will be fascinating for us. But as we live here, we realize that morally, these people may not be necessarily superior to us. And when we face difficulties and discrimination and prejudices, we fall back upon our own, you know, seed values and keep them close and obey them and follow them and transmit them and realize that our value system is very good, is superior, so to say. So these are the major findings of our research.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay. If you have some questions, please.
So what you're talking about, I find the, you know, the spotted leopard image interesting in the sense that so eventually even that there's no say quote total assimilation maybe or acculturation but it is spotted.
Could I answer?
Yeah,
you know, for third world countries assimilation is not expected from host culture. You assimilate to a certain extent, but not totally. You are not required to. You are not permitted to. So adjustment we make, but assimilation we are not allowed to. So we make adjustment and just to make our life, you know, livable. We adjust to certain situation, but assimilation is not expected. But you know, you learn the language, you learn the work ethics, you follow rules and regulations. That's about it. And you all the time you are conscious that you are not assimilable completely.
Now, I think that Victor you.
Yeah.
Came and talked about how Asians are able to say, quote, be assimilated in a couple of generations. And the problem is that the question is really about education level. Economic level.
Right.
That the higher the education and economic level, the more proportions will get assimilated. So in the urban sectors, like say some quote ghetto areas, where people are a little more poorer, etc., then they don't get assimilated. But in the suburbs, let's say, then they get more assimilated. What do you think about that?
I think assimilation to a certain extent. For example, I live in suburb. And I say hello to everyone, everyone will say hello to me. But there are certain things you share with your neighbors, who are American, of course. But suppose there is some real emergency. Suppose I'm in need of money. I'm in need of babysitter. Or I'm sick, want to go to the hospital, and I want just some kind of, this kind of needs. So I would seek help from my own people. There is certain level of, intellectually I can associate, you know, invite them for dinner, have some drink, or you know, we talk intellectual things. We can do a book together. But in terms of real, you know, closeness, you know, it's very difficult.
But I thought this is applies to the individual, first generation only. Now, there are two factors which we have repeatedly stressed in our book, skin color and physiognomy.
Physical features.
African American have been in this country for 400 years. Where is the assimilation? I mean, even in the case of a top-level successful executives or professional, there isn't that kind of assimilation that you will go, I mean, you will meet them twice a week and their children or their wives will come freely to your house and you will go to their house. And if you needed $10,000, they will get it. Or if they needed, you know, somebody, you know, to live in your place for 6 months, you will provide a room for them. That kind of thing is not there. So there are parallels. There is a civil kind of a courteous kind of a distance that is maintained. But at the deeper level, where you really feel that the other person is a part and parcel of your sanctorum, as they call it, the inner, in my opinion.
Yeah, maybe it may happen with one person, you know, but it doesn't happen at a larger level. You get along very well with one person, you are close friends, for some time.
No, the Europeans, like the Irish people or the Italian, because of the skin color and physiognomy, they will get assimilated in a couple of years.
They did. I
mean, although they still want to maintain their Italian-ness, Irish-ness. And that is why you have the Irish parade once in a year. It's a symbolic maintenance of ethnicity. So they can, but I mean, a person from Ghana in Africa, unless that person intermarries with white, and then the next generation happens to be white, and then they intermarry with white, and they forget the black blood in their veins, in that case. But when that doesn't happen, somehow, in my opinion, the physiognomy, the facial features, and the skin color are very, very dominant, and they prevent assimilation in the real sense.
Now, I think that you focus on the skin. I'm trying to, and I'm going. Now, you focus on the skin color, and then and talk about this assimilation or integration or whatnot. But if you look at, say, American society, this, you know, between say black and white, the situation certainly has changed within the past say 50 years, with the civil rights, with all of that. Now, can you say the same thing, or can you project that into the future, another 50 years from now? Is it going to be more integration or less in terms of direction?
No, don't tell me, please. When you say in the past 50 years, integration. Integration in the sense of your civil rights, correct, because they are at courts, and this is, these societies, Western societies, are liberal societies. They treat everybody on paper at least equal. But I am a brown-skinned person, and I know that I was a victim of discrimination 3 or 4 times at my own school. It was my students who came to my aid again and again, and they were all immigrant students, and they came to my aid and they saved me a couple of times. But I was the victim of discrimination.
I think I understand that. I have received the short end of the stick quite a few times, but I'm just trying to think, in terms of say, if we want to look at the situation from a very long perspective and a very broad perspective, in what direction is it going? I don't think it's stationary.
I think
it seems to be going toward that,
right.
But I don't know exactly what.
Right.
Now, we talk about multicultural, how different people can all function and also, interact together, etc. Now, I don't know how exactly that works, but that's a different kind of scenario, to shoot for, it seems.
Tom, my opinion, personal opinion, is that the political rights and your civil rights are guaranteed under these liberal societies of the West. But supposing fairly black-skinned husband, wife, MD, for that, or a high-level attorney, and then there is a very white husband, wife, MD, or high-level attorney. Take 100 of those white couples and 100 of black couples. How out of 200 couples, how many couples do you think would be assimilated in the sense you might be assimilated in your own, I might be assimilated in my Indian circle, people who are brown-skinned like me?
I don't know. I think that we can generate this into a discussion. But I'm just saying that the opportunities of interaction, the media image, for example, of let's say African Americans, have really, I think, changed, because you look at the media presentation, there are now so many black heroes, whereas in the past, we had much, much less, and probably none at all. And so that generates into many other, different
dimensions.
Yeah, dimensions. And so the position, for example, of African Americans, in terms of the media image, they are part of us. So it's not just white.
Yeah.
Whereas some Asians, for example, doesn't seem to belong to anybody.
That's right.
And then they are outcasted by both black and white.
That's right.
The amount of population makes a big difference.
Yeah, I want to say something.
In terms of African Americans, they are a very big part of the population.
No, there is some media figures. some sports figure, right? So they are celebrities, they are celebrated by all. People love them. All people love them because of their, you know, talent, their beauty, inner, outward. But, you know, that is a different thing.
Tom, I agree. The world trend is towards different races and different groups coming together, more and more and more. 50 years later, I think the world will be much more tolerant and accepting of the diversity. But in terms of, maybe, I mean, who knows, 50 years from there, I mean, they might give you an injection and change the color of your skin. Or maybe genetic, you know, no slit eyes, no curly hair, no high cheekbone, maybe. But that is homogenization. But as it is, as things stand.
Actually, you know.
No. Answer my question, please. Can you imagine 100 MD couples with black and 100 white MD couples? How many of them would be feeling close, real close? Like a real kind of intimate friends?
Well, I think that the culture part is an important thing. The language, the culture, I think that it's probably easier for a black and a white American to be friends or, you know, pretty close than for an immigrant from a different kind of culture, but the country, by the language and the culture, that they don't talk Turkey, for example, and, you know, so there is a common linkages. I'm not disputing the fact that there's still a lot of injustice, a lot of inequality, and there's a lot of things that needs to be changed. But I'm saying that, you know, the idea of a spotted leopard is an interesting, and in fact, maybe it's a way of what the multiculturalism,
What we have said is that it is not only the immigrant become the spotted leopard from striped zebra, the host people also become. I mean, when I go to an Indian restaurant, and there in Manhattan there might be 200-300 Indian restaurants. Okay, I go there that I'll find Indian people there. But I'm the only Indian. All the things are mostly white American. When I taught at the college, they were all PhDs, of course, because unless you're a PhD, you cannot be in the higher at a university level. And every 2 weeks, somebody will walk up to me. Oh, Uday, did you go to that restaurant over there in what's called North Suburb? And did you order Malai Kofta? I said, I don't need to go in there. I eat those things at home whenever I want them. So the point is that we have here Mexican tortillas, food. Now, there was one Italian manufacturer, and he was very proud of the Italian bread and Italian pasta and all that. When he found, you see, that there are so many Hispanic immigrants, he started adding Mexican, Hispanic food. A time came, he gave up Italian food altogether. And he is now manufacturing, I mean, tons and tons of Mexican food. And we have given the name also. So, it is that the whole world is becoming spotted leopards. It will.
I'm hopeful, very much. I think it is an expression of ignorance and our own inner insecurity, that we don't, you know, reach out to people. I'm an immigrant. I have taken upon myself this responsibility that I would reach out to people. No one would come to me. I have to go and seeking people. So this way, you know, I need to change with God.
This is the last chapter of our book, a short one, called One Word.
Yeah.
And what is the last sentence of this work? The last sentence is this. Let me read the first sentence. The opening sentence of our book is, time never was when man was not a migrant. Time never was when man was not a migrant. This is a bold and a sweeping statement. And the last sentence of the book is, let's therefore raise a toast to man the migrant, forevermore the builder of brave new worlds. The migrant is helping to bring together the world by reducing prejudices and misunderstanding, and by letting one another know that there are good and bad people everywhere. You cannot say those people, oh, they are all, no. So, what is man the migrant? He is forever, or always, forever, the builder of brave new worlds. So, I think our book is quite hopeful. Yes. Let us hear from these youngsters. Any questions?
Comment? Tell us something about your own experiences.
No, I
yeah.
I just like to make a comment about
sure.
What's happening now with the Islamic extremist movement. Okay. And that seems to be a way to preserve.
Could you speak a little louder? He may not.
Yeah, it seems to be a way to preserve their culture, their beliefs,
right.
And things. And they want to keep it that way.
Mm-hmm.
And they're willing to die for it.
Yeah, okay.
Yes. And that seems to be one movement that's against what you are saying.
It's just
a comment I'm making because I think it's my observation of the world was going, you know, at a very good speed in terms of integration and assimilation, the whole world. And now comes this very big movement. And it seems that the movement has taken a certain route. And that as time goes on, there may be a very big population that says, hey, you know, stay out of here or die, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And the reason is we want to preserve what we have. And it's basically driven by religion. Mm-hmm. That's a negative, to me, that's a negative movement
mm-hmm.
regarding, you know, the whole world coming together.
Interesting observation.
I don't know if there's, Islamic movement has now become so publicized, so well known, so big, in terms of the way they, in terms of, to me, to be a negative movement. I don't know if there are other movements like that, maybe at a very beginning stage or small, you know, in a very small way, also doing the same thing.
I think people want to assert themselves, and they do not like Western powers' hegemony, and they can't fight with them, and they are not equal to them, so they're bringing out their traditions to fight with, to create problems for them. It is a kind of self-assertion that leave us alone and we are no less than you are. against their hegemony and their power. They're trying to, you know, just rebel.
But isn't assimilation some sort of compromise, giving up part of your own value and also taking part of other people's values,
yes.
You know, and also sometimes you preserve whatever, you know, is best for you, best value of your system, and then assimilate some good parts of some other system.
Right.
And it seems that this negative movement that's going along is trying to say that, hey, you know, our system is the best for us,
right.
And don't touch it. And it's there's such a strong reaction,
right.
Towards, you know, other people's values. Like you said, maybe it's a reaction because of power.
Right.
You know, or I don't know what.
It's difficult to understand exactly what they are doing. There are so many different ways they assert themselves.
Sometimes I think of religion as a lot of times as a very rigid kind of a system.
Right.
Then maybe religion is
religion becomes rigid at times and becomes liberal at other times. You know, you see, look at any religion. Some fundamentalists, some extremely liberal, historically.
When you talk about value, is religion part of your value? It's part of your value, isn't it?
Not religion per se, but the values that ride on that religion.
That's it. Say again.
Yes, religious values, many moral values come from your religion. For example, in India, cow is held sacred, right? You know that.
Yeah, I know.
Okay. So, many of the highly educated professionals, they don't eat beef at all. And other people say, why don't you eat beef? I mean, you respect cow in your country, but there are no Indian cows here. There are American cows. So if they get killed to provide you beef, so you no problem. These are not Indian cows. I mean, that is the humorous aspect. But they won't eat beef.
The thing is, eating habits are, you know, cultural, and you are brought up in these habits. They are not right or wrong or anything like that. You just can't eat beef, or can't eat meat, or can't eat certain kind of
cuts. They don't eat, no. It's okay. They don't eat beef because of the religious injunction.
Right, but you grew up in that culture, right?
That's right.
Right, so it's very difficult.
I have a question about the age differential in some sense. You know, the respect for the elders of the Asian community, and then the youth focus among the more, say, Western society. How would that play out as they interact into the future?
The youth and the...
The youth focus of the West,
right?
Yeah.
And the respect for the elders, mm-hmm. in the East.
Here in America?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very difficult. Mm-hmm. In the United States, we have youth culture for quite some time. And they are totally submerged into themselves. And people after 30 are kind of outdated. They cannot relate to people, you know, after 30. It's very difficult. And here we isolate elderly people. And age is extremely, extremely important here. All the time we identify people in terms of age. You know?
This focus on the youth culture. I think all sober Asian people would regard this as highly immoral. I mean, the 1980s was called the Me Decade. I mean, that was not the only decade which was called the Me Decade. I mean, me, me, me. I mean, here American comment, this is my life. This is what I want to do.
You have no business. Yeah.
Here we have given a story of two MDs, Indian. They were both doctors and they had one son. They wanted him to become an MD too. When the son became 13, 14 years old, his grades began to decline. At the age of 14, 15, he grew long hair and he joined a band playing drums. Mind you, not piano, not violin, drums. Okay. They said, look here, what are you doing? I mean, long hair and unshaven and you're playing drums. But it was okay for 1 or 2 years. When he became 17, he dropped out of the school. All right. They were very heartbroken. Because they were telling everybody that we came to America solely for the future of our son. And the son was, okay. Then they asked him to leave home. They were only son, remember. It's a true story. They just couldn't, I mean the point is, that whatever their vision of their son's success, it was, drum playing was not a part of that vision at all. If he had gone to become a nuclear scientist, okay, an attorney, okay, an MD, certainly okay, because they were both MD. But even a great pianist or a great violinist, okay, but what is that nonsense? Okay. I asked him, he said, where am I going to, I can't. Then, about a year later, he left home, no information. Now when he actually left home, the parents were absolutely shattered. Then a couple of years later, some friend called, yeah, your son, I mean this, they were in California. Then they called, somebody called, your son is in New York. And now they had the self-respect, the parent. So they didn't want to call him first, but they were dying for him to call them. Well, he did call because he said, okay, my dad and mom told me to leave home, so why do they care for me? Now, and at any rate, somebody intervened and the son called 1 or 2 years more time. Ultimately, both the father and the mother came to New York and they had a long talk, a number of talks with the boy who was now maybe 25 years old, and they took him home and they gave him a separate room, brought him the best possible drums that he could afford, and because both were MDs making $250,000 each, so they could afford the best. And now the son is unmarried, he has long hair still, and long hair, unshaven and all that. Now, but they say, okay, son, it's all right. Play when we are at work, when we are home. Don't bang on the drum in the middle of the night. The son also had learned his lesson. So now, when the parents' friends come, they are now behaving like spotted leopards. Whereas they were previously striped zebra. Now they say, well, God has given him that talent. Who are we to interfere? They learned this after 10 years.
That's a very good story.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes.
We have about 50 or 60 stories of this kind.
Yes.
From all over the globe, Europe, Africa, Far East.
Do you have a manuscript of ours?
Yes, yes, I do.
If I can have it,
yes.
Yeah. And we were thinking about it. We were trying to publish it. So, would you give some suggestions? Not that, you know, if you can, how to get it?
I think that maybe those are some kind of questions we can talk about it in your setting.
Thank you very much. We enjoyed, you know, coming here and talking about that way.
Thank you so much.